Tell us what your guilty pleasure is.
I'm Hector Herrera. I'm the director of the Ballad of Immortal Joe. And one of my guilty pleasures is I really, really like bad, bad movies that have angels in it. Yes.
Bad or movies series with angels?
Yeah, like...
Like angels and demons,
like,
sort
like
of.
Like the Minion, that TV show that's out there. It's you know, if it's Old Testament and it's like a war between angels, I'll sit through horrible movies from beginning to end and enjoy them.
I'm gonna go with the Mighty Ducks movies.
Oh, I might be on your page.
Yeah.
Cause you feel good.
Emilio Estevez, there he is. He doesn't know how to coach, but they win.
The triumph over all. Come on, that's how can you not love that?
My name is Aidan Shipley. I'm also a co-writer, co-director of boxing. And I guess my guilty pleasure would be really, really bad dance movies.
Give us an example.
You Got Served was like, I thought that that's what cinema was when I was a kid. And I realized
how young are you?
I'm 22.
Okay.
Yeah. So, it was a big moment in my childhood, and I fell in love with those kind of. There's like a dance, like a New Zealand dance movie here that this year that me and my friend Natty are going to see. That we're pretty excited about.
Excellent.
So,
I'm Saul Friedman. I did Bacon and God's Wrath. I directed, animated, and everything in between. Mine is Jumanji. I discovered it late in life. It's not like a nostalgic thing. It was like 4 or 5 years ago I saw it, and I watch it annually now.
Annually?
Yeah.
Nice. Is this a private screening that you have?
Yeah.
Or, okay.
All right. My name's Nick Thorburn. I wrote and directed That Dog. I don't really have any guilt. I kind of just like things and don't feel guilty about them, but I do remember watching Roll Bounce on an airplane once. Bow Wow. It's really good.
Underrated actor.
Yeah, I was fully on board with that movie, but when you're in a plane, there's a lot of things at play, you know, altitude stuff. It can make your brain a little slow, but I thought that was good. And I saw What Women Want in the theaters with Mel Gibson and Helen Hunt. It's kind of misogynist and stuff, but I was along for the ride. Minus the misogyny and stuff.
Okay.
I'm Malina Mackiewicz, and I wrote and directed DESZCZ, or Rain in English. And the guilty... Everyone talked about films, like, really bad, because as soon as you said it, I was like, carbs and masturbating. But then, I can't think of a film.
Wait,
I don't know, like,
guilty.
Stop
you
shouldn't be guilty about that.
No, but, like, in combination.
Still no guilt.
Okay.
That's a whole other conversation we'll have later, by the way. No guilt.
I don't know, probably period, like romantic period dramas.
Like a Jane Austen,
like a Jane Austen.
Prejudice.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. What do you guys think of how your films are consumed? We were talking, you all have shorts. Your short films are in Toronto, for the most part, premiering at some level here. And a lot of people are talking about how film content is consumed. Like, do you care how your short scene, if it's on the big screen? It's on a little screen, if it's on the plane. What do you guys think?
I guess the plane would be lowest common denominator for me, because those screens are you know, mistreated all the time. So it's a kid that already smeared it with, you know, with something. At least for me, it's always been an online thing. And especially now, some of the screens are better than the television, and we have probably not a lot of opportunity to play them in the big screen, which I love. I'm excited about seeing my film on a screen that big. But realistically, when I started doing it, I always thought of, you know, the 1080, you know, full screen, and, you know, on someone's iMac or laptop. You know, I'm not too crazy about the phone because of the speakers, but.
Interesting.
But I think that's I actually made the films thinking that was going to be the output for it.
My first short was on this. It was featured with this kind of anime thing, and it got a lot of views, but it was 10 minutes long, and a lot of the comments were like, how can you call this a short film? It's 10 minutes. Like, literally half the comments were about that. So
I think people who are willing to invest you know, more than 10 minutes in something, also have the care to watch it in a setting that is appropriate. You know, like you said, most online content is like caps out at 3 minutes. So when you're making a short film that's 10 or 15 or 20 minutes, I think those people are committed and they're devoting some amount of time, and I think that'll translate into like watching.
You're right. There is something out of that. Because when I try to do it, I if it's 10 minutes, I feel like it deserves, like, I can't watch this right now, and you know, right. You save for later, and then at some point when you get home,
you
I give it
yeah,
and I
put
give
it on your Apple TV or whatever. Just
I would like it purgatory. To first be seen. As in a theater, of course, like I love it starting at a festival, but then after that, after it's done its festival round and its festival audiences, then wherever, whenever, however is good for the person. Of course, it's nicer if they don't have, you know, crying children around, but that's up to them, really, how they want to consume it. It's fine.
Yeah, I think as the filmmaker, like, you'd love it to be shown, kind of, you just want to make a story that can be watched, and doesn't matter where it is, but I think, like, the filmmaker side of you for sure watches something and you go like, the color was just like a little bit better, which is like, which is awful, because I remember showing it to my parents on like their old plasma TV, and they're and I'm just like trying not to like just like blurt out what should be different, but it's like I think the goal is to make something that should be kind of like viewable from any situation. It's a story that can be told, but yeah, I think the kind of, it is a different audience when you need someone to sit down for 10 to 20 minutes and actually engage in it.
Taking these two points together about which medium you watch it on, and you're talking about like creating it for that platform, I find also, like, I know every pixel of every film I do, and when I watch it on like a shitty old monitor, it covers a lot. So in some respects, it's kind of nice to have it on.
But there's a limit. You mentioned your parents, and I don't know how many of you have gone to your parents' house, and their aspect ratio on their screen is and why are you watching it like this? Don't you see this is stretched?
Shutter, you know, the thing with the frame rate.
I know.
They add a frame, and everything looks like weird. Like Australian soap
opera. But even the aspect ratio, they stretch, and you tell them like, how can you watch this? What's wrong? It's kind of stretched.
But
I don't notice
it. Like, I didn't start loving watching films in cinema until I started working in cinema. And before that, I was consuming it online or like on my TV at home or on my computer. And then now I appreciate and I want to see films in cinemas more. But before I didn't, and I don't think that we can impose on an audience how they should watch the film, because...
go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, it's also important to remember that the people that are watching it the wrong way are watching everything the wrong way. So if your thing is good, it's still, like, good in relation to what else they're watching, because they're messing it all up. For that reason, I don't mind the idea of my stuff being shown on an airplane, because people are sort of trapped and have nothing to
do. I don't mind it. I just don't think it's the ideal.
It's the first choice. Like, they can't just, like, click away to whatever, but... I don't know, maybe we don't, I don't know if I give consumers online enough credit, because like, I don't know what other people do, but I feel like people figure their stuff out. Like, if they can't hear it properly, they'll use headphones.
Right.
I feel like, I don't know if you guys are the same, but I obsess about like, hopefully people watch this with like good headphones and all that stuff, and really it doesn't really end up mattering, because people watch it the way they watch it, and then it's relative to the same way they watch everything else.
So all of this is a sea change over the past, I would say, 10 years, 5 years even. Because you guys are, without a doubt, a new generation, no matter how old you are. You're a new generation of content creators, and definitely of visual storytellers. And people are watching things in a new way. So with that in mind, and what we've just been talking about, how important is audience engagement? As a storyteller, visual storyteller, filmmaker.
You mean like personal? Like you?
Yeah. How important is it to be able to either see your film with an audience, like you will here, or engage with audiences online if that's possible?
It's rare. I mean, getting into film festivals that's the only. Like, there aren't many opportunities you have to show it to an audience, and I think there is like a completely different viewing experience than hearing it with a crowd, and you'll find like nuances and stuff that you didn't even know was there, that some people are finding funny or finding more dramatic than you thought, which is kind of like the only element of like theater or storytelling, that like where it started was you had a live audience and you could hear how people react to it as they were watching it. And so that's kind of, you're never going to be able to beat that, to hear a group of people reacting to something together, because you get a sense from other people what they're finding funny, and you start to see different things that you wouldn't have seen by yourself. So it's different than making content for people who are going to be isolated when they're watching it. So you can only hope to screen it for a group of people.
Does it change your creative process?
I don't think so. Yeah, because you can't, or else then you're not making what... I think the goal for storytelling should always be to kind of... for a group of people, but I don't know. I guess that is changing quite a bit now.
There's no alternative either. Like, you can't... It's, like, the worst to sit with someone watching it online or something. Like, at least for me, to sit with someone like alone and watching your thing, where like they are very conscious of like, oh, like that was a great moment, or like they want to laugh at the right things or seem concerned, and like they're very aware of how they're interpreting the film because they don't want you to be upset. So like in a theater, you can sort of hide in the back or right. blend in, and it gets dark. But like on a you're not gonna sit beside someone on a
you're
plane.
You're right. No, or, but, like, but you know what? You're actually right, because every time you show someone online, it's like those 6 minutes that your film lasts are now half an hour. They feel like a half an hour because you're trying to gauge their reaction, and you know you get a little nervous about certain things, and then you start, at least me, I start seeing all the mistakes when you know when they come up. I'm like, oh, they're gonna notice that
one
thing.
Trust me, you guys. Yeah. None of the audience ever see your mistakes. No, we don't see anything that you see. You were gonna.
I really don't like watching my film with an audience because I get nervous, I feel sick, and I can't focus. And like you said, you notice all the flaws, and you can't get a flow for the film. I love talking to the audience afterwards, but actually sitting there every time, I feel like.
And Nick, you had the audience experience last night. You premiered last night to a packed house.
Yeah.
How did talk about that?
It was a disaster.
I was there. You can't lie about
that. Everyone noticed the mistakes. You said no one would notice, but everyone noticed all the mistakes.
And did they make a list for you?
Well, they just pointed at the screen and looked back at me. And
why?
Yeah,
why?
Yeah. It was terrible. No, it was fun. It was kind of surreal. And it was, it felt like the one in the programming that was a little lighter in tone, maybe, even though it's kind of a dark comedy. It was funny to see people, like, have to sort of shift perspective a little bit and, like, oh, okay, this is, like, it could only have existed at the end of that block, I think, because it would have sort of tweaked everything else or something. I don't know.
So, but in general, I've been, like, for the screeners I've sent out, I've been really overwhelmingly positively surprised by the reaction. Because, like, in a lot of ways, it's a personal project of mine, as they all are. But this one, compared with other works, it does kind of... I have family and friends that I think need to have the same sort of impact, and I don't want to... spoil it for anybody, but anyway, it's kind of interesting to hear the reactions from people. Some people have been very moved by it, which again was sort of a surprise based on, you know, there are some aspects of the animation and editing where I had a much more cynical outlook as I was doing it, not really thinking how it's going to be received,
how enduring it would become.
It's
a documentary, and your lead character is, everybody wants to know her, without a doubt. Like, I want her in my family. And I think Bacon and God's Wrath is a title that helps prepare the audience. I think That Dog is a title that doesn't help prepare the audience, for example. So talk to me a little bit about titles.
We got some flack from it was a Bravo fact originally, but it was just kind of choosing the title of boxing, and we wanted to keep it. The film is not about boxing, really. It takes place in a beginner's boxing class, but it has nothing really to do with the actual content of it, which is kind of why we liked it. But we just had some trouble with people saying, you can't do this. I'm like, why? Because it's too general. Like, you can't... I guess they had trouble getting, like, copyright stuff with it, and it's just... It was overwhelming to, like, everyone, like, it's way too simple. Like, you can't do this. And we're like, well, we kind of want
flushed, it. Like, it's just... Like, that's the name of the sport. You can't call your... short, then you have to use artistic keywords, you have to whisper, like, metaphor and things, and like...
Do like, it's metaphor.
Yeah, exactly. You know, if you say it in a lower voice, then it has more impact. It was originally called that based on an end that we had that took place out of the gym, and then we ended up setting the whole short in the gym, and we kept it. And we could get into, like, how we... compositionally tried to, like, box this character in, how the situations tried to box, like, boxing this character in and all this stuff. But that doesn't make people more comfortable with, like, calling your film
a
sport. Because, like, they're like, well, there's, like, a Nike commercial that's called boxing or something like that. But it was all hypothetical. Yeah. They were saying, like, this could be an issue. We're not aware of any issue.
It was a short film in 1966 called Boxing, so we don't know if
you
should
like say, like, from all sides, like, well, if you do an internet search for boxing, you're never going to come up first. The sports is going to come out, and then you get someone else.
We might be exaggerating, but it wasn't like we didn't have too much pressure. There was always, like, if you can think of a different title, but
After a while, we just couldn't think of anything else it could be called. So kind
well,
of.
Well, I have to say, having seen your film, I can't think of anything else either. Yeah. So I'm on your side. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'm with you. What about that dog?
Well, I think every character in the movie but one could be described as a dog. Mm-hmm. You know, in a general sort of, in a different kind of way.
Wait, which one can't be described as a dog?
The pregnant woman.
Oh yeah, fair enough. I got you.
Yeah.
I got you.
So everyone has this. Everyone, you know, dog being either like a literal canine or a kind of terrible person, like a you know that dog. Mm-hmm. So that was kind of the joke, I guess, was like which one is it? Because there's also a question of like who is. I was sort of playing around with the idea of like names in movies and how names get said a lot in films and. You read a bad screenplay and it just like says everywhere. The person's name in every line and stuff. So it's kind of like a play on like character names and also my friend. I have a friend who has a band from the 90s called That Dog, and so it's kind of a nod to her band, I guess too.
Nice.
Yeah.
Anybody else want to jump in on the title? Say.
I mean, for us, it was. It's a ballad, like it was,
sure.
You know, it's almost descriptive, right? It's a ballad of one of the main character, and the titles of that film and our other two films have come very spontaneously, and that's for our films. But I do like when I like the title of your film. I mean, I think it does prime the audience to a certain expectation. Or sometimes I don't understand why it's called
whatever,
and then you watch the film and you come back to it, and it clicks. And I think it adds a lot. A good title adds a lot to storytelling.
Back in the day of early digital, when it first was all beginning, because I'm the old one at the table and I remember, everybody was being told by people who really didn't know anything, whatever it is, make sure your title of your film starts with an A, because mm-hmm. that will come up first when they do a search on Netflix
I had that realization last year, I think, or 2 years ago with a film. I thought,
so many filmmakers are like, I can't think of anything with an A. I'm like, stop trying to think of a title with an A. It's like the phone book, you know, aardvark with three A's so that you come first.
That's why that movie, I don't know if you guys have heard of that movie, Zizek's Road, with, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, but it's the lowest grossing film. Oh. It made $30 at the box office with like Tom Sizemore and Catherine Hagel. Anyway, they did the opposite where they had two Z's. It starts with two Z's.
So,
yeah.
But here, that honestly, that was like forecasting. We're going to go to the very bottom of the alphabet and the bottom of the box office. So you got to be careful here. What about Ray?
For me, the titles are like the first thing that I associate the idea with, because I'm usually writing more than one thing at a time. So I jot down the word or whatever that makes me think of that idea, and then it usually sticks. It becomes the working title, then I keep thinking about the titles, but I can't think of it being called anything else. So rain is like, deszcz is the Polish word for rain, so that was pretty easy. I was trying to look for a word in Polish for sun shower, because in English sun shower sounds really naff, but in Polish there isn't a word for it at all. So it ended up being rain. You just say like shower, I mean, rain while it's sunny. Yeah, there's no sun. But like I have another short that's called Driftwood Dust Mites. Nothing to do with what the film's about, but it was just the words that made me think of the idea.
Come on,
is
that not a great title either for a film or a band?
Or a song. Yeah.
Like for an English-speaking country,
yeah.
When they translate it at festivals, it's...
It's very difficult.
It's like bits of wood and like fleas.
And little bugs.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Bits of wood and fleas.
Yeah. So. The film that I have in Shortcuts now was an exercise at film school, and they gave us really strict parameters. We had two actors, one location, 3 minutes and 1 day to film. So I just thought of something that I found interesting within those parameters. But I guess in a way it's probably still somewhere deep in my psyche. It's chewing on something that I'm chewing on my whole life.
Well, this is my first film, and I've been in LA, and you know, to make a long story short, I'm around people who make stuff and make films and do creative things, and I was doing a poster for this person or this music for that person, because I do illustration and I do music stuff, and I was like, well, this is something I've always wanted to do. I went to film school. I should actually do this myself, and so I made something that I thought would be easy to make, would only take a couple of days to shoot, one location. So I don't know if it represents everything that I want to do. I want to definitely be able to spread my gossamer wings a little bit with the whole thing, but I think it's a good start. I just, yeah, I like, I think it's a representation of the kind of natural flow of things and characters that you don't really like and that leave before you, like you kind of want to know more about their backstory, that kind of thing where you just kind of get a glimpse of things, so.
I will say, as your neighbor in LA, it's also very LA. It feels like the rhythm of the city very much, from all of us who work in the business, that feels very familiar to me.
Oh, good.
So I think you hit something. You get that those could have been my neighbors.
Okay, good, yeah.
For me, it's a bit of a, I mean, it's technically and creative, like stylistically, it's consistent, but it's definitely a departure in the sense that, like, documentary is not a genre that I really, I didn't set out to do that, and it's, I've been working more with fiction and just narrative work more. So this is a departure. I think I had a lot of fun with it, and I certainly, I think, probably would explore it again, but in terms of if it represents where I'm going, I think very loosely.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, this is like the first short we'd co-directed before. We'd worked on each other's shorts before, but never kind of in this capacity. So I don't know. I mean, I kind of think it's like a combination of the films we did before. Like it kind of meets in the middle somewhere, which worked out well. But yeah, I don't know. It started off as just kind of an idea that we wanted to make, and then expanded to kind of a more personal thing. Like we both kind of dealt with losing somebody and kind of the people that come along with that, and the ways people sympathize, and the ways people like to not coddle, but to kind of show support to people, and how differently that can be interpreted. And sometimes you want someone to give you a big hug, and other times you kind of just would rather people stop bringing it up. So kind of it was kind of the more we talked about it, the more it kind of struck a nerve with us about how people are interpreted when they're just trying to do well. And so that's kind of.
I will say I watched it. I've just lost my dad.
Oh, sorry.
No, it's okay, but thank you. But I watched it right around that time. I was very involved with your lead character,
yeah.
Let me just say, and very happy that she did what she does. I love her.
Yeah.
So I appreciated all of that. But you also have a really unique, in answering this question, you guys have a unique perspective. You're co-directors.
Yeah.
How does that fit into this question about whether this defines you? Like if somebody's saying, okay, we're watching this film, whose voice is this? How do you answer that question?
Well, like I agree with Aidan in that I think it meets in the middle somewhere, in that we had to justify all the choices to each other about things and not sort of do anything to serve our own voice, which can be good and bad. And I think ultimately with this, like it worked out well with this story because it matched up enough with like how we, like our perspective on things.
Mm.
I think for myself, like I like to think of myself as an observational person. So like in that sense, it's like observing a certain type of human being and how the certain type of human being I am reacts to that other type of human being. So I think like in that sense, I think I can connect to it. Obviously like directing something alone, you're sort of fully accountable for it and fully on the line for everything you're doing. But there's also something good about, for everything, every idea we had and everything we wanted to do, just to like have the authority, as weird as that sounds, but like whatever film set hierarchy, have the authority to ask each other why about everything.
Mm-hmm.
And if we couldn't come up with a good enough answer to like leave an idea behind or something.
Yeah, I think on sets, and especially with kind of younger filmmakers, when the crew gets bigger and bigger and you're asked 1,000 questions, I think it can become very easy just to give a quick answer so you look like you know what you're doing. Because for most of the time, when you can ask a question, you want to just, as opposed to really kind of think about it and find out what that means, you want to go, oh, we should do this, because you're trying to keep that kind of, that kind of look going, that you know kind of what you're doing. So it was nice to be able to have someone to kind of go, let's talk about why we want to do this, and if that's the right decision, then we can go back to these and kind of say what we want and why we want to do it. So it was nice to kind of have to justify our decisions.
Yeah, and not that it should be the way things happen, but it does eliminate the possibility of saying because I said so.
Mm-hmm.
And not like
because
like
he
obviously
said
you
right.
Obviously
yeah.
You want to collaborate and have everyone on the same page and understand why you're doing what you're doing and sort of what the end result will be, but it was a really interesting process to be accountable for each and everything.
Mm-hmm.
I will say there's great value as you get older, though, in being able to say, because I said so.
Yeah.
Just saying.
Well, I'm not saying there's no value.
Get a little further.
It's interesting to have that off the table.
No, yeah. that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
I think everything you do is a self-portrait at some point, right? But I think the film represents where I am or where we are. I'm talking about myself and my writing partner, but she has written all three of our films, and I think it's where we are right now. This is what we this combination of what she can do, and cause I can't write for shit, so I needed someone who actually could write. And you know, there's a lot of her personality there in the rhyming, and there's obviously a lot of my personality there in the artwork. And I feel it's a good snapshot of where we are, because even the projects that we're trying to think about now are not anything like what we've done so far. You know, we're thinking about something with less words. We're thinking about something about more adult themes. We're thinking about even the design of the characters. You know, because, yeah, that's the great thing about animation, that you actually design your characters. You know, custom design them. But even the style of it, it changes. So if you ask that question 3 years from now when we have another film, it would probably represent who we are, where we are at that point. And this is, you know, the third collaboration with that. It's the beginning of our collaboration. So maybe later on where we have more fights about it, then it'd be another, you know, it would represent that moment for us.
So that's actually a really interesting answer, and I think a very fair and honest answer as well. And it's going to lead me to another question. You guys doing okay? Can we keep going a little longer? Because you guys are actually really, well, not actually really fascinating. Of course you're fascinating. How many of you went to film school? Okay.
What film school did you go?
And sorry. Little whisper. Where'd you go? So I'm curious as to the concept, and you know what we'll do? We'll wrap this around a bigger question. I'm curious about the concept of film school and how important the ones who went there felt it was for them. The ones who didn't go, if there is something you wondered if that would have changed for you. What does the concept of film school say to you guys as emerging filmmakers or established filmmakers?
Well, I had a weird experience. I mean, I went to film school. I graduated 12 years ago and started a band a few years before that I was graduating. I was like ready to leave film school. Made a few student films. I was like, this is so much work. It's so expensive. I also have this band. I can make this record for really cheap and tour it. And I did that, and it ended up doing reasonably well. And I just lived off that and was like, well, this is what I'm gonna do. And so I went, you know, 11 years without having any aspirations to make a movie. I was like, I'm doing music. And I did that for you know, a decade. And then I moved to LA, I guess. I got the bug. Hollywood fever, they call it. Yeah.
Did you, when you started making the film, you're like, oh yeah, this, I remember liking this. I remember why.
Yeah,
I did this.
It was such an insane feeling. It was like so exhilarating. And I think I'm I have a band and I lead a band and stuff. So I'm really used to bossing people around and just being in control. Like I need that, and it was felt so good. And you know, one of the actresses is so amazing, Andrea Riseborough. The last movie she was in was Birdman, directed by the guy who won an Oscar for directing. So I was like, this is my first film, and I'm doing, like, so scary. But as soon as I got into it, like, she made me feel really good and not scared. Like, it was, everyone was just so great, and it was just such a great experience. And I was like, I got to do this again as soon as possible.
This sounds like a combination of the value of film school plus the value of life experience,
yeah.
And sort of becoming one with who you are and being comfortable in your own skin.
Yeah.
Yeah. People would ask me, like, are you going to, you went to film school, are you going to make a movie? I was like, well, when I'm ready. Like, I'm doing music stuff now. And I think it just took me a decade to be ready, I think.
Yeah, yeah. Fair enough. Yeah. What about everybody else? What about film school, no film school?
Yeah, I mean, I think film school was, it can't really teach, I mean, it can teach you the technique of kind of like, of what to do, but I don't think it can really, like, you don't go there and I don't think you can become a better director than you would have been outside of film school. I think what it does really well is it gives you people that are just as interested in doing this as badly as you want to, surrounds you with good people, and it gives you deadlines, which I think, at least for me, was so important.
But I think also, like, that
not to underestimate having the network built from school, because the first project I did was live action on green screen with, like, I was the only person, I was directing, and I was the only person who really knew what it would look like, and I had no no connections to fill the all the roles. So, because we had some, thankfully we had a lot of Arts Council money, and we had like 35 people on set, you know, and I had, this my first time on set. You know, I think that alone, A, would have saved a whole bunch of money, and just kind of would orient things a little bit more easily for me. Having said that, I still think I probably wouldn't have fared well. It might have killed something for me.
Yeah, there's a lot of luck involved, I think, because you need to have the right people in the right year at the right time. Who are
the team.
Who are like on board with the way you want to make films, and who like believe in you to a certain degree, because there is, at least, I don't know about your schools, but at our school, there was some kind of cutthroat atmosphere that I think was essential. And I had a great experience, but not for the whole time. Like towards the end, it became great, and I could is like for all the same reasons, it was great for me. I could see it sort of like holding someone down and making them I'm very grateful to have gone, but I also think like there's probably people that have had a lot of talent and had a lot of vision, and who went and didn't have the right
timing,
people around them, and then who just like said, okay, I guess this isn't for me. But at the same time, you know,
you can
find that out. Like that you could argue, well, if you don't go to film school at all, then you have to find that group of people organically through whatever channels.
Which can be quite costly, time and money. And plus, I think there is something when you're in film school about going through it together, where you've learned who you can trust. If you haven't gone, you have to learn it in a different way. You have to create your crew that you believe in, that you can go through.
You have to make mistakes in a much more expensive and dangerous environment as well.
There's going to be a lot more. I mean, it's very competitive, which is understandable, because this is an amazing. We get to do what we love doing, and like, so everyone wants a chance to have that, to get to do that. And so going through, I think when I got into film school, I thought I was going to be kind of very like, everyone just wants to make movies together and it's all going to be a great time. There is in the back of everyone's head is like, I want to work harder and do this, because you see your competition, your who you're going to be making films against, and it does, like, it very quickly loses that kind of friendly artistic atmosphere, and it comes very competitive very quickly, because a very small amount of people out of film school can make, and very few percentage of anyone can get like a solid career in this thing. So it becomes very like, who wants it more and who,
I didn't feel the cutthroat thing, but maybe it's different countries, different schools. I don't know. Maybe in Australia, everyone just assumes that no one's gonna make it. So then it's
just, well, but you had a very interesting experience in that you had an exercise in school that said, here are your limitations, make a film.
Yeah.
I once was one of the people who created a program called Fly Filmmaking at Seattle International Film Festival. And it was the same thing. We created limitations to see what could come out of that.
Yeah.
And there's something really creatively powerful.
If you have too many options, like if I have too many options, I don't do anything. I haven't written one sentence since I left film school, because I don't have somebody, I don't have deadlines, I don't have somebody standing over me with limitations and parameters.
I find that, but like, I didn't go to film school. I went into graphic design, you know, but I do teach at a university here, and I do find that those limitations, those deadlines, it gives you a playing field. Mm-hmm. And even for me, like, for years I only worked on client work, you know, and so I never considered myself even capable of doing art, because every time I tried, because I could do anything, I didn't end up doing, like, I did nothing. And it wasn't until you set a certain parameters, you start putting, you know what the playing field is, and you know that, okay, I'm not gonna, if I need to stray a little bit, I'll stray, but you're very aware of it. And then
and you have to, when you have the deadlines, you have to stick to an idea. Like, I write an idea down, and I'm like, oh, that's terrible. And then you get like a week before you have to submit your script.
Yeah,
like, okay, well, I've got to.
Yeah, any commitment, folks, need not apply. I'm just going to volunteer that I will be that person for you who cracks the whip. So if you'd like me to be your deadline woman,
yes,
send me a note. I will be. I'm happy to play that role for you.
I think it's finding out what you like and what you don't like, and it's a chance to because you could sit on something for like 2 years if you wanted to and think about making it perfect. But I think at least when you're starting, at least for me, it was nice to kind of be forced to make projects that you like. Even from the start, you're like, well, I feel okay with this, but you're working with people that you don't really know. But it's important to kind of get stuff done that you don't like, so you can understand where you went wrong, why you don't like that, and that's just as important as making something what's perfect to you, which is.
But even to trust your gut instinct, right? Because there's a lot of things where like you don't commit to certain things because you don't know if it's right or wrong, and then you don't end up doing anything. And as opposed to with a deadline or something like that, you end up you say, okay, I'm going for it, and then if it proves to be the right decision, then you trust that instinct the next time you have an opportunity to make that choice.
But it is interesting how the luck sort of becomes like exponential. Like you need exponential amounts of luck because it's the right assignment at the right time. Otherwise, like, because I think that there you need to have a certain degree of confidence to like to succeed in directing a thing. Like you can't really falter from what you like, because then it spreads itself too thin. Mm-hmm. And I think, yeah, it's like the right things at the right. And I'm not trying to take, like, obviously, like you guys are all very talented. I'm not saying. I just think like but it's the environment for that to sort of like be fostered, because it's interesting, because it sounds bad, but in school, like, you also are there socially, and like we're social people, and you don't want to not have friends, so you have to just hope that the people you're friends with that you want to work with are also like capable, good. Which like, it sounds awful, but like you need to be lucky in a sense that like you get along with the people who can also do things at a certain level.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, so we're gonna have a group therapy session after this, and we're gonna talk about making different choices.
Sometimes I feel like he doesn't appreciate me as much
as he should.
But does he hear you?
Yeah.
All right. So in this vein of talking about sort of what has brought you to the table, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Let's go around the table again, and let's have a different question. And this time, we'll start over here. And it's going to be, and this is general, wide open, can be anything you want. What's the best piece of advice you've ever been given, ever, for anything?
I had Jane Camping come in to talk with us, just for like an hour or two. And she said something along the lines of, the body is the barometer of truth, and if you're relaxed, then your body will tell you if something is right or not. And this is in life and filmmaking and any sort of creativity. You always know it in your body. That's something I live by.
Jane's got some good words.
Yeah, I think
I like
so.
That.
Yeah.
I like that.
All right. that Nike campaign, just do it, I guess. I don't know. I'm really bad at coming up with, on the spot, like recalling. But so I can't think of any
that's
good
okay.
advice.
We can
that's probably why you know. That's probably why my life is where it's at. Because I don't pay attention to anybody.
You're in a pretty good place. Just wanted to remind you. You're in a pretty good place.
You're
right.
I know. I know. I'm just kidding.
Okay. All right. Fair enough. Saul.
For me, it was. It's okay. We're all gonna die. I was doing shiatsu training right after high school, and we were doing a breathing exercise. And I was getting anxious, and the exercises were getting pretty complicated, and I didn't think I could breathe. And the sensei came over, and he's just like, "It's okay. We're all gonna die." And it became easier after that. And
well, there were truer words were never spoken, I guess, be quite honest. Right.
I think the best like advice, at least I still carry with me, was I'm from Stratford originally, so I was an actor in the theater when I was younger. And I remember I got the lines for King John, and there was just like I was like 11, and I just like broke down in tears when I saw how many lines that I'd have to learn. And we had a family friend named Peter Donaldson, who is an actor at the Stratford Festival, like an older, very, very deep voice, distinguished gentleman. And he called me. And he's like, my parents asked him to call me to kind of talk me down, and he just said that like I cry every time I see my lines, like as an adult. And it was really comforting to hear that everyone in this industry like goes through that kind of stuff. And I think in the creative industry, whatever it is, like the directing, acting, whatever, it's filled with just crippling self-doubt, and especially now, more so with social media, people only post the 1% of their life that's great. They post, I made it into this, or I'm doing this, and everyone sees that and goes, everyone else is doing all this great stuff, and I'm just posting whatever I want to on Facebook that's important. But it's no one posts the bad stuff, no one posts the self-doubt, the not working for a while. And so I think it was really nice hearing someone who I looked up to and an adult say, like, I cry all the time, this industry sucks, but just remember that everyone else goes through that, and that if you're feeling like you're not going to make it, like, everyone else is at home feeling the exact same way, no matter their level of success. Like, you're hearing Robin Williams and everyone talk about that, how they were at the height of their game, and they still, like, wanted to be better and couldn't. And I think it's just important to know that everyone in the creative industry is, or and everybody is just kind of dealing with that on their own, and to remind yourself of that.
I kind of feel like we're all hoping nobody realizes that we're actually just frauds.
Yeah.
Maybe, perhaps that's just me. Did I project too much?
I'm not.
No. Thank goodness.
It is. No, I'm not
a fraud. Oh, it's interesting that it was Pete Donaldson.
Yeah.
Too, given that his daughter produced this short.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Very cool.
Yes.
For me, the advice is pretty generic, I guess, which is just like being self-conscious about theater that I'd done, because I used to write and direct theater. That's sort of how I got into it. And someone just who isn't involved in the industry and has no idea was just like, well, do you like it? And it's like, I guess that's the only question. Because if I like it and no one else does, then I should like find something else to do. because you don't want to be condemned to a life of making a ton of stuff that you don't like yourself.
Yeah.
Or at least I wouldn't. So that's just like the only filter, I guess, that I pay attention to. Not, like.
Well, there is that old adage, if you could do anything else, you should do it. Yeah. Because this is hard.
Yeah.
And why would you do it if you didn't love it?
Yeah.
It's excellent advice. Yeah. Hector.
Well, it's a little bit of film advice that I got, but I sort of used it for any artistic thing. And I was told a film is never done. There's only levels of abandonment.
Oh, nice.
And because you're never gonna feel like you're done. It's always gonna feel like I can still make this a little bit better. And especially with films, which sometimes is a long process, right? So when you start the film, and if for animation, for example, like you spend a year working on it, and by the end of it, you got better at doing certain things than at the beginning. And you can't go back and redo the entire film. You just have to, at some point, say, "I'm done. I have to. I have to move on to the next. You know, I have to move on to the next thing, right? So, and that helps with everything. You know, at some point, you do have to say, "I am done. I am done with this, and let it go."
All right. So imagine the people who are watching this and watching your films online and who are experiencing TIFF are, you know, a number of them are going to be filmmakers who are at various stages of their own artistic and creative careers. So think back a little bit and imagine yourself back before you knew anything, way back in the day. Mm-hmm. What's the one question you wish you had had an answer to? That you now maybe have some insight about.
I hate when it starts here.
I'm like, damn it. People keep saying to you, I don't know if this is like the one thing, but it's the first thing that came to me. People always say to you in film school, make sure you like hang on to the contacts that you make because these are people you're going to work with. I wish somebody said, but not all of them. Like, there's going to be like one or two that you're going to really hang on to. Because then, like, I was paralyzed. I was like, fuck, I don't like many people. Like,
yes.
Your friends
and
friends are
going to
love this.
No, I don't mean, but it's just like, even if you like somebody socially and then you like work terribly together. Like, I made a film with a girl that I was good friends with, and then we hate each other by the end of shooting because we just didn't work the same way. And I wish somebody said, like, if you don't find somebody at film school, that's okay. Or you don't have to like everyone or like be that person that's like always on social media and always organizing parties. And like, they'll like try and find people because you can't make a film by yourself. But I don't know, that advice is like, it's not quite right, and it gave me a lot of anxiety in film school.
This is exactly what I was wondering about, so this is good to know. What about you guys? Anybody else?
The world was such a different place when I was in film school. Like, I was editing on a flat Steenbeck with film and cutting, and like, it was mostly demonstrative. Like, the film school wanted us to do. Yeah, it was like a very, you know, whatever. It was the point was the tactile thing was for you to get in touch with the quality of the film and stuff, but it was, there was no social media or anything back then, and I think this beer is making me drunk a little bit. I've lost the thread, but
that's okay.
But I think I would just tell myself, what you said, we're giving advice to our former selves.
What's a question you want to answer?
Or
or you know, something that is a question that. Or
I love that I jumped in and then didn't know what the.
But exactly. That's what beer does for me. Go with your instinct, which is what would you tell your former self?
Just chill out. Just take your time. Yeah. Get just. I don't know. I guess I'll tell myself what I did already. It's kind of like a Back to the Future type thing.
It'll just loop continuously.
Yeah.
I think for me it is. I mean, it's going back to the Nike thing, but I would tell myself, you know, you can actually do this. You know, this is something that you can actually do, and because, you know, at the beginning you're just plagued with like, oh, that's for, you know, that's. You know, certain kind of people, creative people, people have a certain means or contacts or things like that, and it all comes down is to fear of making the mistakes, and I think we're not often told that that's how you learn. You know, we're gonna learn more from your mistakes than from your successes anyway. So, you know, just you someone if someone would have told me you can actually do this, you know, and just pointed me in the right direction, I think I would have started earlier, you know, to making films.
Like Kathleen said, I think, like, everyone thinks they're a fraud. Yeah. Everyone feels like everyone else is, and you've said that too, like, where you see everyone's best selves. Like, everyone puts their best self forward and not their insecurities and that kind of thing. So, yeah, I think having that perspective that it's all attainable, but you have to be determined too. You have to power through, but
you know what? Something that I learned is it doesn't have to be immediate. You know, one of the first projects that I finished that had nothing to do with film. It was just a couple of friends just wanted to do a DVD. We wanted to author a DVD out of an event he'd done, and you just again deadlines. You know, let's meet every week with beers and work, even if it's 15 minutes and talk for 45. That's okay, but every day you chip at it a little bit, and at the end you look back and you've done a thing. And I think, you know, when no one tells you that, you just have to start working at it. You think people just manifest their films that are, you know, I don't know, or have the support system, and it's hard to understand that you can actually do it as well.
What about you guys?
I mean, mine's simple, just because working in the basement in the dark by myself, like, I'd say go out and meet other filmmakers is the main thing. Animation is like, it's a grueling, long process, and you learn so much. I mean, you can learn a lot from staring at your own work for a long time, but a lot more from engaging with other people. So,
I always feel like animators and editors. I'm like, oh guys, come into the light. Come on, get out of the door.
Like, we used to talk about like going into the submarine.
Exactly. Yeah. It's always in somebody's basement.
Yeah.
Editing or animation.
I'm ground level now.
Floor?
Yeah.
Oh, nice. Gosh,
not a lot of windows, but it's a step up.
Yeah. Good on you. As you said, congratulations. It's a move.
I guess like what I tell myself and what's actually useful to people are different. Mm-hmm. Like I don't want to. We already talked about some sort of group therapy situation, which it's not that helpful. But what I think practically I wish I knew is just to pay more attention to like the people you could work with and the people you are working with, what their strengths are, what their weaknesses are, because I think it's easy to like. It goes both ways. Like if you're doing something wrong, it can make someone you're working with look worse. Or if like you're doing something correctly and they're doing something wrong, it can make you feel worse about yourself. More than anything, like pay attention to actors you could work with, because if you can like get good actors, then you could probably make a decent film. Which is like the advice I'd give myself. Pay more attention to actors you could email or call, or like that you could even just run into on the street to try to get in your film.
Right.
I'd say, yeah, like, really assess what you're good at and who can complement that, and, like, above all else, like, figure out what you like about actors and how to connect with them, because ultimately you can be amazing, but you need to have good actors to make a good film, I'd say.
Fair enough.
On the acting front, there was a piece of advice that my teacher gave me once, I think in second year of film school. Because, and I don't know if it's like that here, but in Australia, a lot of young directors are really scared of working with actors. They're like really petrified of approaching an actor. And she said, go to an audition once a month, just so you know what it feels like to be an actor and to know how fucking terrifying it can be. And then, like, based on that experience, work with your actors. And I think that's a nice
have
one to go out there.
Empathy, maybe, perhaps, for that terrifying.
Yeah.
Acknowledge that everyone's terrified no matter what they're doing.
Yeah.
I think the thing what concerned me the most, I think, going through film school was hearing a lot of advice that people are given to just, like, work hard and follow your dreams. And I'm there going, like, well, like, if everyone's taking this advice and everyone's working, like, I could work really hard and I could try my best, and it's everyone's doing it. Everyone's getting told to go follow your dreams. And I think I was just terrified that I'm like, well, everyone's not going to be able to do that. And I think the thing that just gave me comfort was just finding people around me that were in the same situation that I could talk to about that, and just finding people that you can trust and you can work with and still be socially acceptable with is one of those important things. So just finding that team, and I think that's all I can suggest.
Excellent. All right, so what have I missed in this conversation about film and art and creativity and who you all are? What have I forgotten to ask you guys? Is there any should we have them? Should we? Yes, we should have websites.
I was saying that we can give ourselves a bump.
And you can find us at www. Any ideas? Anything that you guys feel like you're...
Any questions we'd like to be asked? Is that
sure, that or anything that I've forgotten. You know, that's the cheater's way of saying.
What are our biggest strengths?
This is not a job interview.
Yeah, right.
I'm not going to say, where do you see yourself in 5 years?
It's the worst.
Yeah, no. I will not say that. I will not say that.
But even with that, this is a fear. Like, going back to the fear of I don't know, this is everybody's first film in a festival.
I had a film at TIFF last year.
And you've had films and festivals before.
Yeah, we were in the same program last year.
I went to Berlin this year, and that was my first. This is my second festival.
I mean, this is my third film, but it's the first one in a festival this size. And you know, going back to the self-doubt thing, it's just it's interesting now to think about is, you know, like the commitment of doing, you know, of now doing this. Nick, you said, like, this is not what I want to do, but I feel like I still have fear about, you know, about that. I still have fear about, you know, what's, you know, is my next project gonna come together?
Does anybody think that fear goes away?
No.
Yeah, I think fear is here all the time.
Fear is good.
Fear is good.
Under most circumstances. There's a few circumstances where it's not.
No, but it's hard to ignore.
Bedroom.
Well, I think fear, exactly. You can't ignore the fear, whatever level it comes at. And so that's part, I think, of what helps motivate you. And inspire you, and because
fear of failure,
or fear
better
of
than being comfortable
sometimes.
Too. Yeah. Like, it's better than being content with where you are, because, like, you should be able to improve on whatever you're doing, no matter what you're doing.
You know what? There is a great good thing you say, because at some point I remember talking to a friend years ago, and I said, well, you know, I don't know if I'm, you know, okay where I'm. And listen, I'm comfortable where I am. And he said, like, you know, comfort is not the same as happiness.
I tend to tell my filmmakers that being comfortable is the kiss of death.
Yeah.
And I actually have had recently had an agent tell me about a particular project that he was speaking to me about. He said, it's a pity that you're actually making a living right now, because if you weren't, you would probably get this other project done faster. And I'm like, that's a bitch to hear.
There's something to be said about being dissatisfied even if you're doing as well as you possibly could be doing.
Yeah.
Go stay hungry.
Yeah.
Like Dee Snider of Twisted Sister Set.
You have to feel worse about yourself.
Yeah.
If you feel too good about yourself, you have to stop.
Which is
another hard part about filmmaking that, like, goes along with the group therapy thing.
You can't get soft.
Like you can't feel too good about yourself, or else at least for me, it's probably different for everyone, but, like, if you feel too good about yourself, then the hunger is diminished. You need to want to improve on what you're doing. You need to be dissatisfied to some degree. You need to give yourself credit, but, like, that's something that people say, and I don't know if it actually, I don't know what it yields.
Okay, but let me ask you this then, because now we have to look at, I hate this term, but this whole life-work balance bullshit thing. So now we have to ask that question about something else. If you're constantly hungry and you're constantly moving and trying, and one of the best pieces of advice I ever got was keep your footprint small so that you can move quickly and fast and not be encumbered. But then you get old.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
See where the conundrum is.
Well, I see the wedding rings on the hands. I'm conscious, I know. Yeah. I feel very married to the work that I do.
Yeah.
And I don't feel like I could ever be, commit to anything other than the stuff that I want to make.
And this is a big conundrum. It's a big question. Am I gonna get comfortable? Am I gonna increase my footprint? Am I gonna have that wedding ring? Yeah. I don't have one, but just thought I'd throw that out there. But you know, does that creation of creating your life as you're gonna live it, what does that do to your creativity, to your drive, to your fear, to all these things we've been talking about?
For me, it's. Oh, fuck, I had the words in my head and now they're for me, it's a balance between living life and observing life. Because as a filmmaker, you're observing life a lot. And I find at the moment, I'm really scared of life at the moment. And I think it's because I've spent so much time observing life and wanting, now, like, I've spent 3 whole years just making films. And now I think it's time to go back and live for a little bit. And then I can observe again, because if I'm observing all the time, then I'm missing out on life, and it's such a beautiful thing, I don't want to miss it.
Well, I mean, for me, I married my writing partner, so we're both that's the trick. And for us, the balance, of course, we want to live, of course, we want to go on a vacation or like take a walk, but it never stops, and it's good to have someone who has that never stop thinking. You know, you go out and you're always talking about it. You're always observing, the same things, and I think you know that for me the work life balance is like this is life. You know, like for me working in this is life. You know, and I think that's how you kind of achieve the balance. Of course, you still have to do some commission stuff and pay for things, but.
We're not going to get married, I don't think, but, I mean, to each other, no. But
if you wanted to, you could.
Yeah.
It's Canada.
It's a
21st century. Yeah, sorry about us.
Here I am in this conversation now, okay?
But no, I often struggle with, like, where should I be in my regular life that's going to help me produce the best work creatively? Like, if I'm just in a really great place, is that toxic to, like, making good stuff? Or, I mean, you have to be able to survive with yourselves, too. I mean, you want to, like, be hungry and want to do better and not be too happy with your own stuff. But at the same time, you still have to be able to go home at night and feel, like, good about your life and what you're doing to survive and to be
functional. Well, there's a dangerous line. Especially if you work creatively, if you work really well when you're not particularly happy. Yeah. That path to the dark side is really easy to access.
Yeah, I bet.
So that's something, too, that I think we have to, like, pay attention to as creative people.
Yeah.
It's easy and sometimes really welcoming to go down that particular tunnel, maybe more than you wanted to know about me.
It may not be a rule either. Like, I'm sure there's people that can be, like, content with, like, everything and work to their best, like, be their best self or whatever in, like, a happy situation. But I feel like if you want to do this, you have to some degree, like, see what suits you best and then, like, try to live a decent enough life around that.
Interesting. Sol, you want to jump in?
For some of the artists that I was working with when I first got started had experienced a certain level of success at a young age, and it kind of got us all thinking, like, if you don't make it by 25, you've failed. And it took a long time to shake that. And in terms of how that work-life balance
Bill Withers, man. He was 31, worked at an airport. He was a luggage guy. Bill Withers. He took luggage off of planes, and he was singing while he was doing it, and someone heard him and was like, what was that? And at 31, that was the start of his
Bukowski,
musical career.
Same thing.
Yeah.
Charles Bukowski submitted to his novels, and it was so long.
I've been thinking about those stories, though, and think of, like, how how toxic are those stories? Like, so many people that hear about that, like, you try harder
well,
and then...
Well, it's a myth. Yeah. Say you're 19 or yeah. you're yeah. 18 and you... You know, these are mythologies that
yeah.
people...
Yeah, and it's dangerous for creative yeah, people to believe these myths.
Yeah, yeah. You,
and that's
myths
what I'm saying
are
is...
inherently dangerous by yeah. default. Yeah.
So, in my particular case, I've tried to make peace with that by saying, it ain't happening for a while, you gotta... pace yourself, and it's...
And where do you find, and also I think it has to do with where you define your level of happiness and success, like how you actually qualify success personally. Is it something that you guys think about, I am successful because my film made it into TIFF, I am successful because I finished a film, I am successful because I had a creative thought and I executed it. Like, how do you guys make that definition, or do you?
It's fluid, though. I think it's always, it's totally... mutable, like it continues to be redefined as, oh, I got into TIFF, oh my god, but, you know, there's always like,
it
but,
bar, sure. yeah, it raises your personal bar where it's like, well, next year if I don't, I'm getting
yeah.
worse,
and it's like, that's a toxic way to live.
Yeah.
No, but it is, especially for I guess us that were, well, we lived a little longer, it changes, you know. It changed. Like success for me at 27 meant something completely different. I wasn't even in this industry. I was a graphic designer, and that meant, you know, a completely different thing. And then now it means it's closer to what you said. I had a creative thought. I found someone to do it, and I finished it. And not to anything else for me at this point is extra,
right?
And
right.
But it might change 5 years from now.
One word. This is a test again. I know you hate this. I'm going to start over here, so we'll take a long time. All right, Nick? So one word to describe the experience of being at TIFF right now with your short film.
Pride.
Nice.
Validation? I don't know.
That's all right. That's good.
Encouraging.
Yeah. Humbled, actually.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's better.
That's good.
Yeah, and like I've had other films play, and I didn't feel that before. This project makes me feel that a little bit.
Trying to find your lid.
Flibber to give it.
Bravo. It was worth the wait.
I just feel like it's a word I've recently learned. I love it so much. It's just a flighty person. I just feel very like discombobulated in a really nice way, but just very I don't know, free spirited.
I like it.
It's nice to be here and just feel like just intoxicated by the whole thing. Yeah.
It's lovely.
Yeah.
Intoxicated is a good word. I was gonna say hi. So yeah, same. Right. So it's nice that I think from. One word. Like celebration, I don't know. It's people are watching films here. There's a film festival. People, audiences are going, getting lost in a world that somebody else created, and they're crying or laughing. And that's intoxicated was a really good word. I'm just gonna take that. Intoxicated.
Yeah, take it. Put me to shame. I picked one of the seven deadly sins.
Yeah.
It's hard
just,
to start.
It's hard.
It's difficult. Yeah.
I just want to go back to Grayson because I feel like he's liked every other word. Do you want to change anything? Or are you good with validation?
Well, I mean, given the word I picked first, it's a bit unfair to go back and,
now it's got to be good.
Yeah, now it's got to be,
every other word he was like,
I'm immediately, like, not validated anymore.
No, that went away now.
Back to neutral.
Neutral, okay, fair enough.
No, it's like, yes, celebrate. Like, yeah, I'm just going to piggyback off of everyone else's words.
Okay.
Hopefully there'll be enough like footage of me like, oh, shit.
So, okay, then I'm gonna take you off the hook, number one, because you're too nice to swing on that hook for too long.
Thank you.
I just want to say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for so many things, actually. Thank you for doing this. Thank you for participating in the first digital remix, which is fantastic. It's a great way for 500 of our new best friends are going to see your work and get to know you, even though they didn't get to come to TIFF, which is going to be amazing. I'm going to say thank you and mean it so sincerely for allowing us to be your festival. That means a lot to us. And I know you guys are like, oh, thank you for... No. It's thank you for trusting that we would take care of your film and we would take care of you. And it means a lot that you've come to us. So many, many thanks. Thank you for being open and having a couple of beers. And just in general, thank you for being really wonderful, wonderful creative people who I get to sit at a table with and have some fun. So bravo to everybody.
To masturbation and carbs.
To masturbation and carbs. Thank you very much. Oh, we really hope they cut that.